New York Attorney General Eric Schneiderman resigning just hours after a bombshell report in The New Yorker with allegations of physical abuse from four women. This report is particularly shocking given Schneiderman's role as a champion for women of the Me Too movement. Joining us now is Ronan Farrow, who, along with Jane Mayer, broke this story in The New Yorker. Ronan, it is the most jaw-dropping story that I've read in a long time. We use the word shocking often, I think, in this news cycle. But this, what you've described, what these four women say that they experienced at the hands of Eric Schneiderman, is like soul-crushing stories. Can you just share with us a bit about what these four women told you?
These women describe, and they produced these fact patterns independently. You know, these are not women who are talking to each other for, in almost all cases. They describe really horrific and serious allegations of abuse. You know, slapping, hitting, choking. Bear in mind, you know, this is an individual who was a very public champion of women's rights, who in fact introduced anti-choking legislation. And he was, according to multiple women in this story, choking them, among other things. And I want to make one very important point, Allison. A significant part of his response to this is to say that there was role-playing in his private life. And I just want to relate the message of one of these women, and it was a shared sentiment amongst this group, that this was not role-playing, that this was not 50 Shades of Grey. It wasn't in a gray area at all. This was activity that happened in many cases fully clothed outside of a sexual context during arguments. In one case, a woman wasn't even in a relationship at all with him, Allison. This was just an allegation that he came up to her at a party. This is a prominent attorney who had worked with him and came on to her. And when she rebuffed him, that he hit her hard. And, you know, I reviewed a photo of the mark that was left after that, and it was upsetting to see. So the allegation that this was role-playing, you know, is not consistent with what these women said.
Oh, my goodness. Ronan, you have so many illustrations that they give you of what they endured. I'll just read one of them. This is from Michelle Barish, Michelle Manning Barish. She was involved with him. So here is just one of the moments that she described to you. All of a sudden, he just slapped me, open-handed and with great force across the face, landing the blow directly onto my ear, Manning Barish said. It was horrendous. It just came out of nowhere. My ear was ringing. I lost my balance and fell backward onto the bed. I sprang up, but at this point, there was very little room between the bed and him. I got up to try to shove him back or take a swing, and he pushed me back down. He then used his body weight to hold me down, and he began to choke me. The choking was very hard. It was really bad. I kicked. In every fiber, I felt I was being beaten by a man. Ronan, look, you and I have talked about this before, how hard it is for women to come forward, particularly with domestic violence. There's so much shame. People say, how could you take it? You know, why would you stay? Can you just describe a little bit about why these four women were compelled and were brave enough to come forward and tell you all this?
Well, to a one, they were reluctant to speak for a long time. Some are still reluctant to speak. You know, not every woman in this story went fully on the record. And the reason for that is, first of all, that it's hard, as you say, for any survivor of sexual violence to speak out, any survivor of any kind of violence to speak out. Second of all, this was doubly hard because this was a prominent and powerful figure in Democratic politics. And many of these women were very connected to Democratic political players. You know, these are formidable women with careers that intersected with his in some cases. And a lot of the time, they recounted having conversations with friends. You know, they all told people at the time, and we interviewed a lot of people who said, yes, indeed, you know, I was there that evening.
Including doctors. I mean, some of them went for medical attention.
That's right. And, you know, I spoke to one of those doctors and looked at some of those medical records, and you know, in that case, a woman was bleeding from the ear in a persistent way afterwards. But the point I want to make is that in those conversations after the fact, a lot of their friends and loved ones said, don't do it, don't speak out against him. And in some cases, that was because they feared the risk of reprisals. You know, they described him threatening people, using his office and his power to say, you know, he could wiretap people or he could come after people. But also in some cases, Allison, those friends warned them off of talking because they thought that he had the power to do too much good for the Democratic Party.
I mean, that That's a story in itself of the sacrifices that people think they make for the cause, the personal sacrifices. Here's his resignation statement. He says, it's been my great honor and privilege to serve as Attorney General for the people of the state of New York. In the last several hours, serious allegations, which I strongly contest, have been made against me. While these allegations are unrelated to my professional conduct or the operations of the office, they will effectively prevent me from leading the office's work at this crucial time. I therefore resign my office effective at the close of business today, May 8th, 2018. Were you surprised by how quickly his resignation came after this article?
You know, it's not for me to anticipate whether people are going to resign or not resign. Our focus here was to tell these women's stories as meticulously and factually as possible. And all I can say about the resignation is that several of the women in this story, who did a really brave, tough thing, and did it because they thought it could help other women, because they saw a pattern of violence here. Several of them have gotten in touch to say that it's been gratifying that they feel they've finally been heard.
The truth will set you free, as they say. And I'm very, very happy to hear that they are happy that they spoke out about this, because it is such a risk. Ronan Farrow, thank you very much for your reporting and sharing it with us.
Thank you, Allison.